Moving across the pond to Europe, May 25th marks the somber fifth anniversary of the Republic of Ireland legalizing abortion. For more than a century, Ireland had some of Europe's strongest pro-life laws, thanks to an amendment in its constitution that protected a mother and her unborn child's equal right to life. Then in 2018, two-thirds of Ireland voted to remove this amendment and allow abortions up to 12 weeks into pregnancy. Despite increasing secularization in Ireland, a majority of its people still identify as Catholic. Helping us unpack this is Niamh Uí Bhriain. She is a prominent leader in the pro-life movement in Ireland and director at the Life Institute. Niamh, thank you for being here today. Let's just start from the beginning. How did a referendum like this get passed in a traditionally Catholic country in the first place?
Well, you know, Prudence, probably very much like abortion gets legalized everywhere. And what you had in Ireland was a country which had a constitutional protection for unborn children. And that was, I suppose, something that was fairly unique. And it was said to me by pro-lifers around the world afterwards, you know, that Ireland held the line for a very, very long time, perhaps for 50 or 60 years after most other countries had legalized abortion. And abortion campaigners saw this, you know, they saw that Ireland had this remarkable pro-life record, and that in parallel with that, we also had excellent maternal health care, excellent supports for women. And one of Planned Parenthood's lawyers described this constitutional protection, this ban on abortion, as the jewel in the crown of the global pro-life movement. Wow. And that was how they viewed Ireland. Yeah, so you had this enormous concerted effort by international abortion campaigners to smash Ireland's pro-life laws. You also, unfortunately, had an incredibly biased media here. Really, the media were the mainstay of the Yes campaign, of the abortion campaign, for many years before the referendum. And it all culminated, as you pointed out so sadly, 5 years ago tomorrow, in 2018, in the removal of the Eighth Amendment of the Constitution and the removal of that protection of the most vulnerable of all our citizens, unborn babies.
Thank you so much for pointing out that Ireland did hold the line for so long. That's such an important point. Niamh, what has been the abortion rate over these last 5 years now that abortion has been legalized? How has it impacted your country?
Yeah, I actually wrote a piece today for Gripped.ie, which is a new media here in Ireland, seeking to bring some balance back into all of these conversations. And in it, I pointed out that, you know, it gave us no pleasure to report that 5 years after repeal of the Eighth, everything that the pro-life movement said would happen has happened. So we've seen our abortion rates go through the roof. Mm. You know, there were less than 3,000 women traveling to Britain for abortions before the Eighth was repealed, perhaps up to another 1,000 getting abortion pills online. We quickly saw that increase in the first year of this really dreadful figure, 6,666 abortions in the very first year of it being legalized in Ireland. It stayed like that for the next 2 years. It shot up last year, according to our health minister, to 8,500 abortions. So this appalling rise in the number of abortions in Ireland. And we were promised, you know, voters were promised in 2018 not to be concerned about rising abortion rates. They were promised abortion would be rare, that the government would work to keep it rare. As we know, happens everywhere, Prudence. That's not what happens when abortion becomes legal. Voters were also told there would be no late-term abortions. And now we're having reports in peer-reviewed journals of doctors saying that performing late-term abortions in Ireland felt like stabbing the baby in the heart. They're talking about having to get sick in the corridors. And you know, so we're seeing all these appalling outcomes. Babies with Down syndrome, we're told now by the master of the biggest maternity hospital in Ireland, he's saying that 95% of babies diagnosed with Down syndrome in his hospital are being aborted. So these shocking outcomes that we've seen everywhere, this is what happens when abortion is legalized. And these are outcomes that should give us pause, I think. We're urging people here in Ireland to rethink abortion, to take into account that these outcomes are everything that the government and the abortion campaign has promised they wouldn't be, and to rethink what's happened to our country and to rethink the sheer scale of the devastation that abortion has led to.
Yes. And the church in Ireland was deeply impacted by years of ongoing sexual abuse cases with many Catholic priests at the center. And I'm curious, in terms of how that impacted the culture, do you think this undermined the church's position on other social issues like abortion in the eyes of the Irish people? Do you think that had an effect on this constitutional amendment being removed?
I do, absolutely. I'm afraid so. And What happened, there was a very clever campaign in the media in the 6 months running up to when abortion was legalized to bring up again and again some old historical cases and some wrongdoings, mostly historical ones, I have to say, not current wrongdoings in regard to the church, in order to kind of create this mood amongst the Irish people that women had been wronged and that restitution needed to be made for that wrong. And then in parallel with that, abortion campaigners in the media were making the argument, which makes no sense at all, that to legalise abortion would in some way restitute some of those historical wrongs. And of course, you know, we've always pointed out is that abortion is the opposite of compassion. You know, it's the opposite of ever righting any wrong, because abortion kills a baby and it harms a mother. And we're never going to empower women. We're certainly never going to create a better culture for mothers and babies by legalizing abortion. And that's precisely what's been happening here. You know, we were promised that our maternal health care would improve if the eighth was repealed. That's not happening. We're seeing women dying in maternity hospitals here in Ireland in what was traditionally a very, very, very safe place for women to give birth. We're seeing growing numbers of women reporting anxiety and depression in this country. We're seeing growing sexual crime rising. I'm not saying those things are directly related to abortion, but what I'm saying is that women were promised a better culture, a more progressive, better Ireland if the eighth was repealed. That's certainly not what we got.
Sure, sure. Niamh, is there any hope that this referendum, could be overturned?
Well, here's the thing, you know, when after the 8th was repealed, and you have to remember that the people who fought to keep to insert the 8th into the Constitution and then the next generation who fought to keep abortion out were devastated. You know, they were absolutely heartbroken. And I think one of the things that really brought light back into the narrative was when Roe v. Wade was overturned by your Supreme Court. You know, after decades of trying, after decades of keeping the path lit. And I think what's really important for the pro-life movement now is primarily to keep the faith. That's the first thing you have to do. You have to keep the faith.
Yes.
You have to keep the belief alive that people will realize that there is nothing compassionate about abortion and that a truly progressive society would absolutely reject abortion. And one of the ways we do that is, of course, to shine a spotlight on these horrific outcomes, to remind people that in terms of this country, there have been 31,000 abortions since the 8th was repealed. That's the size of a small city in Ireland. You know, we are actually aborting our future. The outcomes are absolutely horrific. We have to keep shining a light on that. And we have to keep making what I think is a very persuasive and persistent argument that women are not best served by abortion, that we can do better for our mothers and babies. Yes. There was a really horrific, I think, insight into the thinking of the government shortly after abortion was legalized, when our health service posted on its website advice for women who would take the abortion pill, and they told them to flush the remains of their baby down the toilet. And I thought it summed up not just the extraordinary disrespect for the unborn child, the absolute lack of regard for that child's right to life, to its dignity, to its human value, but also an absolute lack of respect for women, an absolute lack of regard for them. And I think that sadly, because everything we said would happen in the referendum has now come to light, you do see people who voted yes, writing letters, posting on social media, like, this is not what I voted for. This is not the outcome for women that I was told would happen if the 8th was repealed. And I think, you know, in keeping the faith, in keeping the path lit, in persisting in reporting honestly and fairly, and in shining a spotlight on these outcomes and in demanding better for mothers and babies, that's how we will change the culture, just as you managed to change it, and you're still working to change it in the US and elsewhere, in countries like Poland, in Hungary and elsewhere.
That's right, that's right. Well, Niamh Uí Bhriain, thank you so much for joining us. Know that we in the pro-life movement in the United States are praying for you in Ireland. Keep fighting the good fight.
Thank you so much.